Hi, I'm Sharon Maclis at IDG Communications, here with Do More with R, Turbocharge R Markdown Interactions with Runtime Shiny. R Markdown is one of my favorite things about modern R. It offers an easy way to combine text, R code, and the results of R code in a single document. And when that document is HTML, you can add some user interaction with packages like DT for searchable tables or Leaflet for zoomable maps. But if you want to amp up that doc's potential for interaction even more, consider adding Runtime Shiny. Shiny is a web application framework for R with a pretty specific format. It requires special selections for the user interface and server logic, and extra code to place each item that's displayed. Syntax for a Shiny app layout can be daunting for first-timers. What you might not know is, you can turn an R Markdown document into a mini Shiny app without a lot of that rigid structure. It's a nice way to ease into learning the framework. You can jump right in and experiment with user inputs and results without worrying about typical newbie problems like nested parentheses and where all the commas go. And even if you're more experienced with Shiny, a Shiny document can sometimes make sense if you don't need a full-blown application. I find it a useful way to test functionality before worrying about layouts. So let's get started. This is a conventional R Markdown document with a table that shows some demographic data by Massachusetts zip code. I'll knit that into an HTML document the usual way. The table is searchable, so users can search by zip code. I'll check out the zip code for our office. Can search by city. Search by city in the right column here. Can search by one specific county. And then even sort to see which counties have the lowest and highest incomes. Which ones have the lowest and highest monthly housing costs. However, no matter what I do with the table, the histogram doesn't change, and neither does the text. It would be nice to have even more information that's interactive. I'd like the user to be able to select individual cities and see everything on the page change, not just the table. That's where Runtime Shiny comes in. I'll open a copy of this same document and add Runtime Shiny to the YAML header. Look carefully at this knit icon and see what happens once I add that and save the document. Did you see a change? Now instead of knit, it says run document. That's because this is now a mini Shiny application. I've also added Shiny to the packages I'm loading here. I've got another copy of this same document with a line of code that adds a drop-down list to the document so that users can choose one or more cities. Select input is the function that creates the drop-down. So let me go over the arguments to that function. Make that a little larger here. The first one, my cities, is the variable name that will store whatever the user picks. That second argument is the text that will appear with the drop-down list. The third argument, choices, lists all the possible values in the drop-down list. In this case, I'm taking all the unique city names in my data set and then sorting them in alphabetical order. Multiple equals true lets users select more than one city. And finally, selected equals Boston defaults to Boston being the selected city. Pretty straightforward so far. There are a few important points about what happens next. My cities is no longer a regular R variable. It's dynamic based on user input. And that means you can't refer to it as just my cities anymore. Instead, it's now input my cities. Anything that uses the dynamic input is also dynamic. And that means it can't be treated like a regular R variable either. You will save a lot of headaches when working with Shiny if you remember that. Values, such as a data frame, need to be reactive. That's as easy as wrapping it in a special function, but you need to remember to do it. Anything that displays dynamic content, a table, a map, a histogram, or even text, needs to be rendered in a special way, using one of Shiny's special render functions. The good news is that Shiny takes care of most of the functionality of monitoring for changes and calculating results. We just need to remember to use the special functions. So let me show you what it means. Let's go back to RStudio. I'd like to create a data frame called MyData that filters for any rows where the city is one of those cities that the user selects. However, a plain dplyr filter command won't work. Here I've got just a plain filter command. Let's run this. Do you see the error message? My cities isn't found because it's not a regular R variable. The way Shiny works, I need to refer to it as input my cities. My cities doesn't exist anymore. I'm going to open a copy of this, change that to input my cities, save it, and now run it. See that I still get an error? You likely see that error a lot when you start with Shiny. It means that you're trying to create something dynamic the regular R way. Instead, you need to make it reactive. Fortunately, in this case, it's as simple as using the reactive function. So let's show you that in my next copy of the document. See how this is wrapped in the reactive function, reactive, parentheses, and the brace? Now I'll run that. And you see we now have a drop-down list, but it doesn't actually do anything yet. So let's add a data table. This is plain data table code, but it won't work either for two reasons. First, my data is a reactive expression, not a typical variable. So I can't just use my data to access its value. I would need to refer to it almost like it was a regular function with parentheses after it. Let's see what happens if I run the document now. This error message is a bit cryptic, but what it says is that my data isn't a data frame or matrix, which is what data table needs. In fact, it's a reactive expression. So let's fix that by adding parentheses so that data table can see the value of the expression and not the expression itself. So I'll save that and run that, but I'm going to get an error message again. Let's wait for that. Ah, here's one that we're already familiar with. I'm trying to display something dynamic in a regular R way, and that won't work. To fix this, I need one of Shiny's render functions. A lot of visualization packages have their own special Shiny render functions, and DT is one of them. The wrapper function is renderDT, and I'll add that around my data table code. This is renderDT. Parentheses bracket, and then I'll just put these below the code, save that, and run it again. Now I've got a table, and if I add another city here, the table will update. And I can use the same MyData reactive expression to create a histogram that's dynamic as well. You can see here, this is conventional ggplot code wrapped in a renderPlot function using the same MyData value. Let me run that. Now you see if I add Amherst, the histogram will change as well as the table, the text as well. I can even add a map using the leaflet package. Here's my map code, and I'll run the document. Boston is highlighted here. Zoom in a little so you can see that better. It's a histogram for Boston, the table in Boston. Now if I go back and select Amherst as well, we should see the map change, the histogram change, and the table change. I'll add Framingham so you can see where our offices are on the East Coast, and there it is. And that's changed as well. That's a lot to take in. And if you're new to Shiny, you'll need some practice, like with any coding skill, before it starts making more sense. But if you always remember that anything dynamic, values, or displays need special treatment, that's a big step forward. For more details about code used in this episode, if you're watching this as a standalone video, check out the accompanying InfoWorld article at the URL on your screen. A final point about R Markdown Shiny documents. Once you add Runtime Shiny, it's not an HTML file anymore, it's a mini application, and that means it needs a Shiny server to run. Anyone with R, RStudio, and the Shiny package has a Shiny server on their local system, so it's easy to share these with fellow R users. You could send them a document, or you can post it online as a zip or tar file and use the Shiny run URL command. There are special run GitHub and run gist functions for documents on GitHub. But chances are, at some point, you'll want to show your work to non-R users. That requires a Shiny server somewhere not on your system. One option is RStudio's Shiny Apps I/O service. It's free for a few limited public apps, but you'll need a paid account for anything serious. You can also build your own Shiny server on a cloud service like AWS or a Google Compute Engine. You just need the free open source version of RStudio's Shiny server software. There's a great step-by-step tutorial for doing this on the DigitalOcean cloud service, where you can build and run a small Shiny server for just $5 a month. That's it for this episode. Thanks for watching. For more R tips, head to the Do More with R page at go.infoworld.com/morewithr, all lowercase except for the R. You can also find the Do More with R playlist on the YouTube IDG Tech Talk channel. Hope to see you next episode.